Hello everyone, welcome to the channel, I hope you're doing well. If you're new here, my name is Mark, and on this channel I upload at least 2 videos per week about aquascaping and everything else involving the planted tank hobby. In this video, I would like to cover the basics of planted tank fertilizing. This is a topic that can easily get very complicated, but in this video, I'll do my best to explain to you in a very simple way. Plants need nutrients to grow. And if your goal is to grow lush and beautiful plants, it will be good to get some basic knowledge on this topic. So let's dive right in. The most important nutrients for plants are nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. These are also known as macronutrients. And if you're keeping fish, shrimp, snails, or other inhabitants in your tank, it's very likely that there's already a small amount of these nutrients inside your aquarium. You see, your fish and other creatures produce waste, and their waste contains ammonia, which is transformed into nitrates by the bacteria that live in your filter and your substrate. And fish waste also contains a little bit of phosphorus and potassium. You see how easily this can get complicated? So basically, fish waste contains all the macronutrients for your plants. Problem is though that the amount is usually not enough. The macronutrient potassium is needed in large amounts, and fish waste only contains very little of it. So that's why we need to supplement the aquarium with fertilizers. If you have a densely planted tank, if you're injecting CO2, if you're running medium to high light, I definitely recommend that you add these nutrients. Besides nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, plants also need micronutrients, also known as trace elements. For example, iron, copper, zinc, basically just a bunch of different metals, and then some more. These are nutrients that plants only need a small amount of. High chances that your tap water will contain some of these micronutrients, but again, usually not enough to satisfy the needs of the plants. So it's good to supplement these as well. Alright, so now you know a little bit about macro and micronutrients. Now let's talk about nutrient deficiencies and how you can spot them. If your plants are lacking a certain nutrient, they will often show that with deformed leaves, pale color leaves, or stunted growth. So earlier we already established the 3 most important nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. So let's see how plants react when these nutrients are not available for them. When there is not enough nitrogen available, new plant growth will look very pale. So if you have a green plant and the new leaves look very light green compared to the older leaves, that can be an indicator for a nitrate deficiency. When there is not enough phosphorus available, plant leaves will slowly be covered in green spots. This is green spot algae, which usually appears when phosphate levels are really low. When there is not enough potassium available, plants will get small pinholes in their leaves. And sometimes these small pinholes can get a yellow circle around them. Now there's a whole bunch of other nutrient deficiencies that you can spot. And if you search on Google for aquarium plant deficiencies, you will find all these pictures and charts showing how a nutrient deficiency can look like. For the most part, these are quite accurate. So I suggest you use them as a guideline whenever you think your plants are lacking a certain nutrient. Now let's discuss some popular fertilizing methods, starting with the EI method. EI stands for Estimated Index, and this is a method of fertilizing that was invented by Tom Barr, a very famous aquascaper from the United States. With this method, you basically dose a lot of nutrients so your plants will never starve. And every week you do a large water change to reset those nutrient levels. So for example, on Monday, Wednesday and Friday you dose macronutrients, the NPK. And on Tuesday, Thursday and Saturday you dose micronutrients. Sunday you do a large water change, and on Monday you start again from the beginning. The good thing about this method is that it is quite cheap, because most of the time you can buy these nutrients as dry salts that you mix yourself. And these salts are relatively cheap compared to liquid fertilizers. Then there is the ADA fertilizing method. And this method is usually combined with the ADA substrates, which contains a lot of nutrients already. The basic ADA fertilizing method therefore only consists of micronutrients and potassium. The ADA range of fertilizers and substrates is great if you're into aquascaping, but they are definitely not the cheapest option. Let's do one more and talk about the lean fertilizing method. With this method, you only dose the bare minimum of plant nutrients, just enough to keep your plants healthy. With this method, your plants usually grow a bit slower, and this is great if you don't want to trim your plants too often. This method is also great if you really want to bring out the red color in some plants, as the low nitrates boost the colors of those plants. So what fertilizers should you use? Well, if you're a beginner, I really recommend you to keep it simple. You'll find that these days there are a lot of all-in-one complete liquid fertilizers on the market. And for beginners, these are perfect. A good quality all-in-one fertilizer will contain nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, iron and trace elements, all in one bottle, which makes life a lot easier. Some all-in-one complete liquid fertilizers are not actually complete though. Manufacturers will not add nitrogen and phosphorus because they assume that plenty of that will be available in your tank from fish waste. So when buying your liquid fertilizers, always check the label to see if it actually contains all the macronutrients. And I will also leave links to fertilizers that I recommend in the description box below. Now we have talked mostly about liquid fertilizers, but what about substrate fertilizers? Well, plants can take up nutrients through their roots as well as their leaves, so ideally we want to have both liquid and substrate fertilizers. That's why I always suggest people to use Aquasoil in their tank, as this is a nutrient-rich substrate and it will really help your plants to establish those healthy roots. And the good thing about Aquasoil is that it's capable to soak up the liquid fertilizers that you are dosing and slowly release them to feed the plant roots. But if you don't have Aquasoil or you don't want to use it, you can use root taps as well. These root taps usually come in the form of capsules that will slowly dissolve in the substrate. Alright, I think that covers all the basics of plant-to-tank fertilizers. Now let's go over some frequently asked questions. And first question, do plant fertilizers cause algae? And many people have different opinions about this, so there's a good chance that you will hear some contradicting stories. But just fertilizer on its own does not cause algae. But when it comes to these nutrients that we talked about earlier, you want to have a certain amount of it available in your tank. If there's too much or too little of a certain nutrient, that can lead to algae issues. At the same time, if you already have some algae issues in your tank, adding more and more fertilizer can only make matters worse. Right, second question, when should I start dosing liquid fertilizers? And this depends a little bit on your situation. If you are using some sort of Aquasoil, I would start dosing after 3 weeks of setting up a new planted tank, because soil will leak plenty of nutrients in the beginning. If you are using inert gravel, I would start dosing from the very beginning, but start with half the recommended dose. Question number 3, do my plants need liquid carbon? Well, liquid carbon in my opinion is a great product to kill algae, but it does not replace CO2, and I think your plants will be just fine without it. And the last question, are fertilizers safe for fish and shrimp? And the short answer is yes, aquatic plant fertilizers are safe for fish and shrimp. Sometimes people are afraid that the copper in liquid fertilizers is harmful for shrimp, but the concentration of copper is so small that you really have nothing to worry about. Alright, that's it for this beginner's guide into plant nutrients. If you have any more questions about plant-to-tank fertilizers, comment down below. I hope this video will help you out on your plant-to-tank journey. If it was helpful, click that like button, it only takes a second and it really helps to spread this video to more people. If you made it all the way to the end, I really appreciate it. Thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next one.